It's the biggest event to hit Kansas City in decades. After months of planning, it's finally arrived. Get ready for tens of thousands of out-of-town visitors and lots of national media coverage as Major League Baseball's All-Star Game descends on Kansas City. Hello, I'm Nick Haynes, and it's great to have you with us again as Kansas City prepares to host Major League Baseball's All-Star Game for the first time in 39 years. All-Star activities are expected to attract as many as 150,000 people, with events throughout, starting tonight, going through to Tuesday night's big game. Even if you're not a baseball fan, you're certainly going to be touched by this big five-day celebration. City leaders say the game will leave an economic impact of about $60 million on the metropolitan area. With us to explore its significance, the preparations, what's involved, and who's picking up the tab for all this are some of the officials most closely involved in making all of this work. Kansas City Royals Vice President of Community Affairs and Publicity, Toby Cook, the President and CEO of the Kansas City Convention and Visitors Bureau, Rick Hughes, Royals Hall of Fame Director, Kurt Nelson, who will be putting this into an historic context for us, and Kansas City Mayor Pro-Tem Cindy Serco. Thank you all for being with us. You know, put this into context for us, would you, Rick Hughes? You know, how does this All-Star Weekend compare with other, first of all, big events and conventions that we've had over the years in Kansas City?
Well, you know, you look at basketball in March, and we'll drag down about $20 million throughout the month of March. I think what's really significant about this, in addition to the crowds and to that $60 million, is that we'll have some 33 million viewers worldwide, 217 countries that'll be queuing in, and we think that'll have a lasting impression on the great things happening.
And all of those media calls are going to you, Toby Cook, as the Vice President of Communications there at the Royals.
Well, it's been unbelievable. We've heard from all over the world. But it's interesting because as we hear from all over the world, we hear a lot of people who have never been to Kansas City and aren't very aware of the Midwest. And our real goal in all of this is to put the Royals, Kauffman Stadium, Major League Baseball, Jackson County, Missouri, Kansas City's greater metro area, and the Midwest on an international map, and I know we're going to shine.
You know, this time last year, Cindy Serco, Councilwoman Cindy Serco, you were in Arizona on a fact-finding trip with city and county leaders to see how they were doing it in Phoenix. And now it's all finally arriving right here in Kansas City. What did you learn from that trip?
Well, you know, I think the first thing is everybody said, well, they have a downtown stadium. How can we do this because we're so spread out? And I think what I learned very quickly is that that impact was really just in a two-block area, that we're going to get to take advantage of being spread out and really showcasing our city to so many visitors. That was the first thing that I thought of when I was in Arizona. We have more than anything that can hold up to Arizona. We are made huge investments in our city, and we're shining right now. So we've got a lot of attractions.
Okay, but we are spread out. And one of the things we heard when you pick up the Kansas City Star was transportation. We are a terrible transportation city. And yes, the stadiums are all the way out there. And most of the events are happening in the sort of downtown area on the plaza. How are you going to transport thousands and thousands of people and fans from sort of Crown Center area and the plaza and get them out to the stadiums? Are you worried about that, Toby?
We're not worried about it because we know that the city and the county has been working on it since well before Phoenix. We've always admitted that it's a different dynamic. For instance, years ago, St. Louis hosted it, and everything was close together. It wasn't the case in Anaheim. It hasn't been the case in some other areas. But we've been told by MLB that they believe that the fact that the city has so embraced this and has made this sort of the signature event of 2012 will more than make up for any inconvenience that people might experience. But we also know that on July the 11th, after this whole thing is over, if people can say, you know what, that wasn't bad at all. In fact, Kansas City really had its act together. We didn't have trouble getting around. Then that's a success.
You also have thousands and thousands of volunteers, Rick, who have helped with this whole event.
I think it's pretty indicative of the great turnout and the great fan-friendly spirit that this community has. I think in previous years with baseball, they were still right up to the month of June, and they were still collecting volunteers. We shut ours off, back in February with some 6,000, I think, that we have going. I think that's a
6,000
really nice
people
turnout.
Who said they wanted to help?
That's right, yeah.
For free?
That's right.
Wow. Now, Kurt Nelson, you know, we've hosted it twice before.
That is correct, yeah.
But then, though, even in 1973, there was only such a thing as an all-star game. There wasn't all of these other things around it.
You know, it really was, Nick, because when you look back, we have a press kit from the 1973 game that I like to look back at. And you look at the schedule of events, and it's all scheduled right around Monday and Tuesday. And none of them are really public events other than the ballpark event itself, which was All-Star Game, which in 2012, that's completely different. Things are starting today, and they'll run all the way through the game on Tuesday. So there's big events every single day. If you don't have a ticket to the game, there's a lot of events that you can take part in, then be part of the All-Star experience at Fan Fest or the parade that's going to be on Tuesday, which is free to the public down at Country Club Plaza. So it's really going to be, it can encompass everybody.
So you don't have to have an astronomical amount of money to experience this All-Star weekend.
That's exactly right. You can go to Fan Fest, which is a great experience for fans of all ages, families. There's so many activities that are going on down at Bartle Hall for that. And then, like I said, the parade on Tuesday, all the other events that are going on around town. I know the city's putting on some great events down at Barney Alice Plaza
Let's look at a rundown of the All-Star events, starting tonight with the All-Star Fan Fest at the Downtown Convention Center, which runs through Tuesday. You have a charity 5K on Sunday, a celebrity softball and future game also on Sunday at the K. There's the Home Run Derby Monday night. On Tuesday, there's the red carpet parade on the plaza. And this all before the main event, the big game, on Tuesday night. But they mentioned, Kurt mentioned the Fan Fest. When you were in Arizona, Cindy, did you go to the Fan Fest there?
We did go to the Fan Fest, and we had Kansas City clothing on, and people would stop us and say, we're so excited to be coming to Kansas City because the small markets really understand how to put it on a show for the fans.
By the way, here's some amateur shot video by a fan at last year's Fan Fest in Phoenix. I mean, you saw some of this.
Yeah, I did that.
Yeah, you did that? Oh, wow.
Yes.
It's not going to affect your re-election chances, I hope. Okay. So what do people actually do there, though, Toby?
It's what baseball likes to call baseball heaven on earth. It's basically a huge celebration of Major League Baseball and anything else that you can imagine. So a big deal is autographs. We're going to have countless legends, former Major League Baseball players and all-stars that are there that will be signing autographs throughout. Once you get into the event, those autographs are for free. So unless you're buying a memento or concessions, there are no extra costs. But you can also see stage presentations. There's interactive games for the kids like we just saw a few minutes ago. It's just all baseball all the time in that big Bartle Hall.
Now, also at the Fan Fest, you're going to have a chance to see some of baseball's greatest memorabilia. Thanks to the National Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, they are bringing some of its crown jewels to Kansas City.
When we go to a Fan Fest in any city, we have a number of items that we bring along that run the gamut of baseball history. We go old, new, Hall of Famers, not Hall of Famers. We bring items that are related to All-Star Games and items that are not related to All-Star Games. See, this is Babe Ruth's jersey. This is one of several jerseys that we have from Babe Ruth, donated to the Baseball Hall of Fame by Babe Ruth, by his estate, back in 1948. This is one that he wore back in the 1930s. The good heavy wool, just exactly the kind of thing that you want to wear on a good summer Sunday, you know, for a doubleheader. This is Ted Williams' 2000th hit bat. And so, you know, whenever we're bringing items, we like to make sure that we get some of the giants of the game.
Well, Kansas City has such a great connection to the Negro Leagues as well, and I see a couple of Negro Leagues artifacts down here.
Yeah, you know, Kansas City is the sort of the spiritual home of Negro Leagues baseball because of the Negro Leagues Museum. This is an amazing ticket from Eastman, Georgia from the 1950s, and if you look very closely on it, you'll notice that it says colored on it. This was for the, as they called it that day, the colored section of the ballpark for that minor league ballpark. African Americans getting this ticket to go sit out in the special area. Sometimes, as here, it was a special area that was denoted. Other times it was simply by tradition. This is where the African Americans could sit. You don't get a chance to stare racism very often in the face. This is one of the things that we allow people to do here at the Baseball Hall of Fame. This is George Brett's jersey from 1983. George Brett, of course, in many ways is the face of the Kansas City Royals. I think that there's probably no ball player who's more associated with the Kansas City Royals than George Brett. Statistical leader in so many batting categories, one of the all-time greatest third basemen ever to play the game, and obviously, you know, there's no way that you can go to Kansas City and bring artifacts without having something from George Brett.
Okay, those are exhibits that are coming from the National Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown that will be at the Fan Fest. Kurt Nelson, you've also brought a huge box filled with memorabilia that are going to be at the Kauffman Stadium as part of a special exhibit at the Hall of Fame there.
Yeah, we have a display down at Fan Fest as well with John Odell and our friends at the National Baseball Hall of Fame, but we also have an exhibit at the Royals Hall of Fame at Kauffman Stadium, a special one dealing with All-Star games in Kansas City, and I brought a couple artifacts. My favorite is really this one right here. Which this is a program from the 1939 American Association All-Star Game, which was played at Rupert Stadium or Rupert Field, the ballpark at 22nd Brooklyn, I like to call it, because we most of us know it as Municipal Stadium. But this is actually the first All-Star Game that was in Kansas City. And the Blues were in first place at the 4th of July on that particular year, so they got to host the game. And both shortstops from this game are in the National Baseball Hall of Fame. Phil Rizzuto for the Blues, and Pee Wee Reese was a Louisville Colonel, and he was playing on that American Association.
And you're allowed to touch it without wearing special gloves,
I am, because this is part of our collection. I probably shouldn't be, but this is television.
Yes,
so
I'll keep my coffee cup way away from it. All right.
Another couple of things is these are pennants from the 1960 game. Now, the 1960 game was the first Major League Baseball All-Star game here in Kansas City. This one was at Municipal Stadium, so there's a couple of pennants. These sold for $1 at the game, which I always like to remember what the prices were on some of these things. But there were so many Hall of Famers that played in this game as well, including three Hall of Famers that played in this game and returned in the 73 game. Brooks Robinson, Henry Aaron, and Willie Mays all played in both the 60 and 73 games. A couple of interesting items from the 73 game. This is a handbag that Mrs. Kauffman gave to the Lancer wives. The Royal Lancers being a key group in Royals history. The Lancers and their wives put in a lot of work on the 73 game, and this was a keepsake that they had. And then there's this 1973 All-Star Game ticket, which the price on this one is $8, so it was a little bit different back then. But that's for that 73 All-Star Game at brand new Royal Stadium at the time.
Thanks for reminding me about that.
Yeah, thanks
question.
For reminding me.
Yeah, I do, absolutely, because we did a show about this not so long ago about why the tickets never went on sale in Kansas City to the general public, did they? And they talked about how in Arizona, the tickets were on sale to the general public and not in Kansas City. They went only to season ticket holders, who then put them onto Craigslist, and they were selling upwards of $500 a pop.
There was actually a 2 or 3 week period where we had a lottery going and we did sell to the general public, but it was a very short window. And it really speaks to the fact that the Royals and MLB got together and said, we want to thank our season ticket holders, not a few of which became season ticket holders in the off season so that they could have first dibs at All-Star Week. And, you know, it's no secret that when All-Star Game comes to a market, that team wants to maximize their season ticket base by getting people to buy. So it went very, very quickly. And we really did get to a sellout situation sooner than other markets did.
So are there tickets available if you still wanted to go to the All-Star Game?
You know, we've got these events that are coming up on Sunday and Monday. We've got the Home Run Derby on Monday. We've got the Futures Game and the Celebrity Softball Game on Sunday. And at last count, we literally had singles in the upper deck, a couple of hundred. They might be gone by now, but the All-Star Game is sold out, although in this secondary ticket market that we live in, somebody's going to find a way in somehow, one way or the other.
Where do all of these people stay, Rick Hughes, when they're coming into town? We have hordes of people coming in for this big event, and we've been told by people like you for a long time that we don't have enough city hotels.
Well, there's still, tonight is beginning to snug up downtown, the downtown Crown Plaza area. I think the Country Club Plaza is booking up pretty well, but there's still space available. And you have 33,000 rooms in the area, so we can accommodate pretty good crowds.
Would it have been easier with a downtown convention hotel?
Well, it might have been a little easier. I tell you that the downtown or the convention hotel was not a factor in the decision for Major League Baseball here because there's such disbursement, and it was not a big deal for them in the way they would need to aggregate their VIPs and their players and such.
Is bringing a All-Star game to town bigger than bringing a Republican or a Democratic National Convention to town?
Well, they're a total different beast, as you can imagine. The Republican or the Democratic Convention has a huge buildup to it. It consumes quite a bit of space and time, and you have to move groups out of there. So this is a much cleaner event and probably has economic impact that's pretty similar.
Okay. Now, Kansas City has been pulling down some of its ugliest eyesores to welcome out-of-town visitors just in time for the All-Star Game. The city is tearing down unsightly houses that visitors might pass on the way to Kauffman Stadium and other venues hosting All-Star events. Just one of the efforts the city is undertaking to prepare for the glare of the national spotlight. While everyone is happy the city is sprucing up for its big moment, there seems to be an underlying resentment in some of these neighborhoods about why it has taken the city so long to tear down these homes when there have been blights on their blocks in some cases for more than a decade. Do you understand that resentment, Councilwoman Serco?
Well, I can see how they feel that way, but I think they should celebrate what we're doing. I relate it to my son graduated from high school this year, had his party at my home. We did trimming and painting and cleaning up because we knew our home was going to be full of guests. That's no different for a city. We wouldn't expect the Royals to do such a great job of bringing the All-Star Game here and not be part of sprucing up and cleaning up. It is a fresh coat of paint, and that's what people do when they have guests.
Now, this is not just an event for Kansas City, Missouri. Cities all across the metro have been sprucing up, getting ready for the nation's spotlight, as you'll see in this report from 41 Action News.
This new banner went up today to welcome All-Star visitors to Raytown, the closest suburb to the stadium.
We consider ourselves the backyard to the ballpark.
The mayor says the city needs to look good.
When they're driving from the hotel to the ballpark and they're driving through Raytown, they're going to remember if they see a dilapidated building.
Bauer joined other suburban leaders in a show of unity to talk about spruce-up efforts. Parkville is trying to finish fixing English Landing Park after last year's flood. Suburbs are also doing sign sweeps like this one, taking down signs along power poles and roads. They say cleaning up is a regional job.
We look forward to working with our surrounding partners and communities and counties to make this a better metropolitan area for everybody.
But the beautification effort includes some self-promotion.
Being the best downtown in America, so we certainly encourage any visitors, anybody locally, to come visit our downtown Lee Summit.
First of all, we don't have any potholes in Merriam.
Certainly some competition there among cities. So it is certainly more than just a Kansas City, Missouri project. But even if you're not a baseball fan, you don't care much about sports, this does have a huge benefits for the community. You're also giving a lot to charities as part of the Major League Baseball All-Star Game coming to town. Toby Cook.
Yeah, Nick, this is the life that we've been living for the past, well, almost 12 months now since we went to Phoenix and scouted it out and saw what they did. Major League Baseball a few years ago decided to establish a program called the Lasting Legacy Program. And the proceeds from Monday night's Workout Day Home Run Derby are all going to go to charity. Some of the MLB national charity partners, and then about $2 million is being left behind in charitable projects, primarily in Kansas City and in Jackson County. So we're renovating a Boys and Girls Club, a couple of youth fields. We have an exhibit that we're paying for at the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum called Before They Were Stars. These are Negro Leagues players that went on to play in the Major League All-Star Game. We're sprucing up Operation Breakthrough, an inner-city child care facility. And this is a cool one. We're giving about $250,000 in scholarships to kids around the metro if they go to a Kansas or Missouri college. The whole idea behind this is you go by that renovated youth field, you go to Operation Breakthrough, and you say, that happened because the All-Star Game came to town. Or if you're one of the students that got a scholarship, they can say, you know what, I got to go to school at least in part because the All-Star Game came to Kansas City. And that's about as cool as anything that we're doing.
You know, the All-Star Game for some people, Kurt Nelson, is, oh, it's just this exhibition game. It doesn't have much significance, even in the sporting world. Oh, it's just, what is its significance in Major League Baseball history?
Well, you know, it started in 1933, and it wasn't really a baseball event when it first started. It was tied to the World's Fair, the Century of Progress World's Fair in Chicago. It was organized by a gentleman by the name of Arch Ward, who Mayor Ed Kelly and Colonel McCormick were worried that the World's Fair was going to not get the influx of dollars, so they wanted to come up with a big sporting event, and Arch Ward came up with the All-Star Game. So that's really where it started. But you know, today its influence on Major League Baseball is the winning league in the game actually gets to host the most games in the World Series. They get home field advantage in the World Series. So the game itself does have some significance inside of baseball. But the historical significance of it, that you know, that's gone on for so long, all the way back to 33. The only year that wasn't played was 1945, and that was only because of the end of World War II and travel restrictions. So it's become really part of the fabric of a summer here in the United States.
This will be the third time that Kansas City will have hosted an All-Star game. Have other cities hosted it three times?
There's been several that have hosted it three times, but the one thing that I will say is Kauffman Stadium itself will become only the fourth ballpark that's still in use today that will have hosted the game more than once. So it goes to show you the time period that Kauffman Stadium has in Major League Baseball. It's one of the older and more revered stadiums in all of baseball.
Now, one of the concerns early on about this was the transportation, which we brought up, something we haven't touched upon, which I've seen you quoted on in many, many news stories over the last several months, was the security issue. And I know you have always been tight-lipped about that because you can't say too much about the FBI and all of these agencies that are involved. But looking at the weather forecast, even looking at the... It's going to be very, very hot, and I see up until Thursday of next week it's still in the triple digits. Is that the big concern right now about the heat?
Oh, I think we're going to have to take that into serious consideration. We unfortunately got a little bit of a practice run on it not that long ago when the Cardinals were in town, and we had two-day games, and we had near 100-degree temperatures. I'm a little irritated at one of my friends who's a meteorologist in town because he told me this dome of high pressure might very well move out by the time the All-Star game comes in, and the extended forecast didn't look great. But we're pumping up everything, so we'll have extra people on hand to keep an eye on people in the stands. Our first aid will be just absolutely chock full and busy that night. And I'll go ahead and throw out that caution. I mentioned Aramark, our food and beverage provider. They love when I say this on TV, but drink less alcohol and we will have free water out there in the concourses if it gets that hot. You can buy all sorts of other items, but we really want people to take care of themselves. And thankfully, except for on Sunday when our futures game starts in the middle of the afternoon, the two big events on Monday and Tuesday are in the evening, and it just does get a little bit more bearable at Kauffman Stadium once that sun starts to go down.
What is your biggest concern at this point, Rick Hughes?
My biggest concern is that we have the best possible images that are being projected out there. Most of the media wanted to wait until they got here to really see the town festooned with all the fanatic stuff and that, and make sure that we're really putting our best foot forward.
Do you think this is an opportunity for Kansas City to attract other big events now that they see if we do a good job on this one?
Oh, absolutely. I think it resonates with anyone who's planning conventions, meetings, sporting events. If you can handle All-Star, you can handle just about anything.
But what would be a conceivable event that we could top the All-Star game with?
Well,
if we don't have a downtown convention hotel, could we conceivably get?
It's interesting you mentioned this earlier. In town this weekend, we have Republican National Committee chair and co-chair that'll be looking at the city. And I think if they see this pulled off, that there's an opportunity that we could bid on them in 2016.
Yes. What is your biggest concern at this point, Cindy?
Personally running the 5K charity run.
Oh, you're in that, are you?
Yeah.
Good for you.
Yeah. So, but no, I think that we're ready. We came back from Phoenix. As a matter of fact, while we were in Phoenix, we started having meetings amongst ourselves saying, okay, what do we need to be doing? Who needs to be put together? We've been doing the dry runs. We have a great command center. Gene Shepard has been fantastic in pulling that together. The mayor's staff has been so enthusiastic in trying to shepherd this through City Hall, the manager staff. We're ready to just wow people. So I don't know that there's a concern. We really felt like we've checked all the boxes and we've ran through it 2, 3, 4 times.
I was also on your website, by the way, and you were also mentioning watch parties that the city is hosting.
Watch
so even
parties.
If you didn't have any money whatsoever and you just wanted to do something completely for free, there are watch parties that the city is hosting?
Well, you've mentioned the economic impact. So our little less than $2 million investment for that type of impact to the city is worth it already. But part of that money is not just all going to impress out-of-towners. We also are doing watch parties across the city. We have Crown Center, Guadalupe Center, 18th and Vine, Zona Rosa, the zoo. Am I missing one? I think that's all of them.
Okay, we're going to put these on the Weekend Review page, okay? We're going to link to all of those sites so you'll know where all of those are happening, plus all of the events of the All-Star game we're going to put on our website, too. But they're absolutely free.
They're free. Okay. Bring your long chair, bring your blanket,
And your
enjoy.
Fan and mister.
And your fan
yes.
and your mister.
Yes.
So we want our citizens to be a part of this experience.
Yeah. Any lingering concerns for you, Toby?
I was thinking about the bad pun of inside baseball, but For us, we're totally confident at what's happening outside of Kauffman Stadium or the Truman Sports Complex and what's going on downtown. So our big focus over the next few days is making sure that we pull off these community events. And then once we go out to the ballpark, putting on an all-star game is a collaborative effort with Major League Baseball and the host team. And this is their show. This is a Major League Baseball event that we're hosting at Kauffman Stadium. You can just imagine over the course of the last 12 months, with all the departments, with all the details, we have to just make sure that on our end, we give MLB what they need in order to pull this show off. It's going to look great on TV no matter what. We just want to make sure that the people that are experiencing it see this as just a really, really big baseball game at Kauffman Stadium rather than something that's unruly. And it takes a little while to get it down from unruly to manageable in this planning process.
Yes. But you still have a smile on your face through it all.
The one thing that I'm worried about is to get the American League a win. We're 0-2 in Kansas City, and as an American League city, we really want the American League to come through and get a win here.
Yes, because the whole goal should be that you are also going to have a World Series that you're going to get out of all of this, too.
We're looking forward to that, and we're working towards it, and that's our goal, is to have a big event in October.
All righty. That is our special All-Star Weekend edition of Kansas City Week in Review. Our thanks to our guests from the Kansas City Royals, Toby Cook and Kurt Nelson, the president of the Kansas City Convention and Visitors Association, Rick Hughes, and Kansas City Mayor Pro Tem, Cindy Serco. I'm Nick Haynes from all of us here at KCPT. Thanks for spending part of your weekend with us.